So I have with me Professor Rajesh Zele, whom I will introduce, and then he will respond to any questions or comments that you may have. So Professor Rajesh Zele gave you the content on professional conduct, and I can think of nobody more appropriate than him. He is one of those rare people in IIT who has extensive experience both in industry and in research and teaching. So he is an alumnus of IIT Bombay, graduated in electrical engineering close to 30 years ago, and then went on to do his PhD at Carnegie Mellon. Subsequently, he worked as a technology developer and a business person in several businesses. He is very well known for his work in wireless communication especially. And then he joined back IIT as a professor in electrical engineering. So he comes with first-hand knowledge of issues related to soft skills and workplace communication. And he has in fact been teaching some of these to our own students here. So we were very glad to have him on board for this particular course. So I'll now hand you over to him. Any questions, comments that you have, any clarification that you seek on this module, he'll be able to respond and answer to this. I'll hand you over to him.
I'm really happy to participate in this activity. One of the reasons I'll share with you what's on my mind right now. I have worked for about 2 decades in the industry, both in India as well as in US, and I get to interview many of you who are just graduating out of school, and you know, who want to be in my team or in our company. And consistently over a period of years, what I was seeing was there was an element which was lacking of being a professional. And it's not the student's fault. It's something that you were expected to know, you know, on your own. And I kind of learned it, you know, after so many years. And I wanted to kind of present whatever I have learned directly to you, so that you can benefit from my experience. And that's what we are all supposed to do as teachers anyway. So I'm really excited to be here, and I was very happy when Professor Parthasarathy, he called me for this unit. I hope whatever I talked about made sense to you. If you have any questions, any scenarios that you would like to ask me, I would be very happy to answer those questions. Thank you.
What we'll do is, if any of you have very specific questions, or if you have clarifications, or if you would like Professor Zele to explain something further based on your own experiences and your own aspirations, you can raise your hand. After that, we'll have a general round to some of the colleges and take your feedback also on this particular module. Yeah. So please click on the raise hand button. Mahakal Institute of Technology Ujjain.
Madhya Pradesh, yes.
Okay, Madhya Pradesh. Welcome. So please ask your question.
Yeah, please state your name. I would like to know your name.
My name is Gaurishankar Sahu. Sir, I have a question related to assignment, sir. If I have a team and I am a leader of my team, our faculty member has given us a assignment which is, should be submitted on a particular date.
Okay.
So, date. And if we are ready, means we are highly dedicated to complete our assignment on proper date which is given by our faculty members. But on that particular time we could not complete our assignment. So at that time, what should we do? Means in our classroom, if we will look. So our colleagues will just doing like copy paste. So that time what should we do? Means we should also do assignment. We should also complete our assignment on proper date with dishonest or honestly. We should complete our assignment after that particular date.
Okay. Gaurishankar, excellent question. Gaurishankar Saha, right? Sahu. Okay.
Sahu.
Thank you for the question. And it's I can feel your pain, and I can understand your dilemma, right? Finally, in my opinion, right, you should not let your situation decide your future, right? Whatever is going around you, The clarity of thought you should have is, what do you think is the right answer? Can you tell me what you think you should do if the environment around you was not there?
Yes, sir.
What do you think you should do?
Means, I know only one thing, that I have to learn things. I don't just have to copy paste. Means I want to learn. So therefore, I should complete my assignment with full honest. Means if it is not complete on that particular date, but I should be honest with my with myself on that assignment. Means, sir, I wanted to complete my assignment with honestly. Means I want to learn something from that assignment. Means I don't just want to complete assignment as finish my work.
Good, good. So Gauri Shankar, you hit it absolutely right. What you are saying is what you need to do is the two things I would do, okay? Because I see as a teacher, as a professor, I deal with this day in, day out. Students are always, you know, students at IIT are extremely smart, and they are extremely smart at manipulating their professors also, okay? So they will give all sorts of reasons to extend the dates, but I put my foot down, and all I have to do is only once I have to hold the line, and after that they will never push me again. So so my theory is very simple. You do your assignments honestly, and you make sure you deliver it on time, because an assignment that's finished late is no good, in my opinion. Okay, so you have to start early, yes. You have to plan early, you have to finish your assignment on time, because it's not just what you do in your assignment, but delivery on time is very important. And this is the lesson you will carry forward when you go work somewhere else, right? Because let's say you are working at ISRO, and there is a space shuttle going out in space at certain time, and you didn't finish your work on time, the space shuttle will get delayed, right? And that's not acceptable. So I'm giving you an extreme example, but you really have to finish everything on time, and for that you need to plan what you are doing. And also at the same time, it doesn't hurt to communicate with your professor and tell him what you are observing, and the professor will be very sensitive to your concerns, you know. And like for example, in my class, if I see any assignment, every assignment we check for you know, copy paste type of behavior, and whoever does it, they are disqualified, just like a dope test in sport, you know. So you know, you should not let what other people are doing decide what you want to do. You need to do what's the right thing in your belief. If you let other people decide, then your life will be a Hindi movie, let me tell you, okay? So you got to decide your own future.
Yes, sir. So that at last time, what should I do? Means I should say to my professor that this particular time I am unable to complete this task. So means I can take some more time to complete this assignment.
Generally, taking more time doesn't work with the professors, unless they really everybody in the class says that, you know, they are not able to understand something, then the professor will extend it for everyone, because from the professor's point of view, things have to be fair, and if he's giving you more time, means he has to give the entire class more time. So think about that also. So my suggestion to you is that you submit whatever you have finished so far and tell that you have not completed that, and it will be okay. It's okay to get less mark, but if you got those less marks with honesty and integrity, right, they are a lot more valuable, trust me. You will be able to hold your head high when you get your degree, and I wouldn't worry about what the other copy paste are doing, okay?
Gauri Shankar, one point that you made is extremely important, and I would like everybody else to also pay attention. You mentioned that you want to learn. Your objective is to learn, no more. So that is what should guide you, because you yourself gave the answer that copy paste is not going to help you to learn. Okay, whereas even if do partial work and submit it, you have learned something on your own, and you are going to learn by completing it later also. So that's an extremely important, because our objective is to learn and be better at what we do. Okay, so that's the takeaway from this. Okay, I would just just to add to what Professor Zele was saying, yesterday I received a letter from the University of Chicago. So this is to mark the 125th anniversary of Swami Vivekananda's speech at Chicago. They are giving scholarships to 100 students from India, and they asked me to recommend 5 from IIT. And you know what they told me? They said, please don't go by marks. Okay? Please don't just go by those who are toppers. there may be others who are not toppers, but who have the motivation and the ability and the sincerity. Those are the people we want here. That's what they told me. Okay? That's what is important for you as well.
Excellent.
Thank you, sir.
Can we go to the next center? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Gauri Shankar.
Solapur.
Sihagad College of Engineering, Pandharpur. Please state your name and ask the question.
Hello, sir. I'm Dipali. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Sir, we are really happy for this conversation, which workshop you took for us. Because, sir, there were so many questions in students' mind also that about soft skills and workplace. That also you cleared all the questions. And, sir, the main advantage of this face-to-face interaction was for the student was that the students have in their mind this feeling that that if we are going to speak, if we are speaking with the person with the high respect and high position, then they have respect plus fear. But now I think we all students are having only respect for you and not fear.
Thank you. That was very nicely put. I'm honored.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
What is your name?
Hello, sir. I'm Sharvari. I'm really thanks to you that you give us chance to interact with you. And it's really improve our for self-development, communication, and how to interact, our behavior. And also, I like that you always start with on time every session, your punctuality. And I learned so many things from you. So thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. Yes.
You know, have any of you done an internship anywhere? Is there anybody here who's done an internship in a company? Yes. So based
sir,
on
now in this same our college organized the program for internship. Now they planning on Monday they planning for the internship.
Okay. So based on your internship experience, you must do you have any questions about professional conduct? Because what he talked about is about when you take up jobs, once you graduate from your institutions. But some of you must have some work experience when you did an internship. So were there any issues or problems you faced when you did this internship about which you would like to ask a question?
Sir, we done the entrepreneurship. That time they not totally give the guidance in some companies. And that is the session that we conduct for the development, our development, and they not give proper guidance. That time, what we do?
So, Amruta, I really thank you for your courage to ask this question. Many times you go through places where you don't get any feedback, right? You are in an environment where nobody is there to help you. You can blame yourself, or you can be proactive, and you need to identify the right person who can work with you. So, you know, any workplace where you go to, it doesn't matter internship or any other place, right? You have to connect with people, you have to bond with people, and you have to make relationships. And these are all professional relationships so that, you know, they get to know you and you get to know them. And then in case you need help, you can open up to them and you can ask them the right question. So I would say that when you should not expect somebody to come out there and sit down at a table and help you. But it's the responsibility is yours to go and approach people and be just like you asked me this question right now, right? You need to do the exact same thing. And don't be afraid, because you are intern and your job is to learn, right? So you don't be afraid by any means. What's the worst thing that can happen to you, right? They will fire you. And not a big deal when you are an intern, but they will admire your courage. And trust me, nobody will fire you if you ask the question. They will really appreciate your boldness, and you will go a lot further in your career if you continue that approach. Thank you, Amruta.
Thank you, sir.
Myself, Akash Yadav. Sir, my question is that suppose I am a fresher employment in a newly company. So, what should be our cooperation with our company so that the result is beneficial to our company?
Okay, so generally when you are hired in any company, right? Yeah, Akash, now I can see you. Okay, okay. So I think your Akash, your question for so that everyone else understands, right, is if you're a fresher in the company, then how should you work so that whatever you do helps the company? Does that make sense? Is that what you're asking? Okay, so
yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, good, good. I was waiting to hear that. Imagine, right? I mean, either you're an internship candidate or you are a new hire in a company. You really need to identify. It depends on the company. If you are in a big company, then the hiring team is different, and people who you are reporting to is different person. What you really need to identify is your mentor, who will make sure that you succeed in that environment. So, I'll tell you from company's point of view, what are they thinking, right? So if the company is a healthy company, then the team in which you are going to be there, they want to make sure that you do your job correctly, so that and you get trained in the process, so that it's helpful to the company's overall bottom line, right? Every person, whatever they do, it does matter to what the company is doing. So even when you are getting trained, it is going to matter, because the next project you're going to be performing on your own, right? So initial period of training, you really have to put your heart out there so that you can learn whatever you need to learn during that process. So you may feel at times that directly you're not doing anything, but be patient. In the initial phase, you'll be in the training mode, where you will be learning a lot of things, and then you will get to use whatever you learned in the next project. But have an open channel of communications with your supervisor. Meet with them often. You know, people generally, what I see is that the freshers try to avoid people who are they're intimidated by their supervisor or supervisor. You should not do that. You should be you should interact with them, even a hello, and asking questions about the other side makes things interesting, right? So for example, if you're joining my company, and if you're walking by my office every day, I see you, but you don't even smile at me because you're afraid of me for whatever reason, right? That's no good. Take that first step. You got to drop your inhibitions a little bit. Say hello, introduce yourself, and tell us what you're doing. And when you break that barrier, if I'm in that shoe, first of all, I will do it to you, okay? But there may be people, supervisors or bosses, who may not do that, who may be very busy. But it's the thing is in your court, that you need to have that interaction. So interact with as many people as you can in a new environment, because in the beginning is when you are going to make your first impression, as I said, right? So that first impression is important, and you talk to many people. It doesn't matter how your language skills are, how your communication skills are. What matters is your genuineness, the honesty with which you speak. Your desire to communicate is more important than the actual words that come out of you. Everybody reads you through your eyes. So as long as your genuineness is reflecting in your eyes, you will be fine. Okay, so make an effort to communicate with people around you, and everything will start falling in place. But if you just quiet down and you feel afraid interacting with anybody, then you're not going to make much progress. Does that answer your question, Akash?
Sir, one thing is that in starting, so many perceptions we felt that because many seniors are present this company, that's why every decision which we make, so it is the process, but it should be true or wrong. So in which case, what should we do?
Actually, he wanted to ask that as a fresher, if he is working in a company and he is actually exposing to so many seniors, and people, they get conscious about what is wrong and what is right, they get hesitant.
Mm-hmm.
So in that situation, what he should do?
Right and wrong is, it can be relative, right? So I think what you need to choose is right and wrong based on your core values and your beliefs, right? And there could be times when you're wrong, many times. That can happen in the beginning. So it doesn't hurt to talk to other people and ask them, hey, this is the situation. Can you help me with this thing? The most important word in your initial part of your work is, hey, can you help me with this, right? Keyword is help, and people will open up to you just like that, okay? Do not be afraid, ask that question. Hey, I need your help, I'm not able to figure it out. Is this right or wrong? And that way you can sound off ideas with other people. You won't believe this, but I do this all the time, even now with my students. Whenever I have a doubt, I ask them, hey, you know, this is the issue that I'm having, what do you think we should do? And many times I'm doing that intentionally, but I'm just telling you that it works in reality also. In reality also, you can, you don't want to force your opinion, but you want to get other people's opinion, candid opinion, and that candid opinion can also help you. So don't be afraid to ask other people's opinion. But finally, you need to do what you think is the right thing, okay?
Okay. We have a lot of people waiting to ask questions, so we'll move to another center. There's one person who's sent us a question via chat. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amruta, and thank you, Akash. Yes.
Akash, yeah. So K.S. Rangaswamy has this question from Namakkal. Give us some tips to handle negative peer pressure, because this is related to this.
So I will repeat the question. The question from K.S. Rangaswamy College is, how do you handle negative peer pressure, right? And especially if this is happening in the beginning phase of your career, right? There are many layers to answering this question. Let me put out a few scenarios for you. You just joined the company and you are in a scenario where you know, somebody else doesn't like you, right? One thing you need to remember, right? Not everyone is going to like you in any place that you go. And you have, as soon as you understand that fact, life gets lots easier, right? So if you feel that somebody is putting a lot of pressure on you, and I'm assuming it's not your supervisor, then the best way to deal with situations like this is, as much as possible, do not react, do not respond. You need to do your work right, you need to do what you believe is the right thing, and you need to communicate with your supervisors, you need to communicate with your colleagues who you're working with. If you feel comfortable, you can let them know, hey, this is what is going on. But then do not react, confront, you know, any kind of on negative pressure. Now, the other kind of negative pressure could be a test for you. People may put negative pressure on you in a company environment where they are trying to check you out, okay? So you really need to be able to, again, you know, withstand that pressure. Do not react, have a reaction which is instantaneous. Think through what is going on, and always, you know, my rule of thumb is, when I get into a negative situations, I kind of like to wait and, you know, listen to myself, and then whatever negative thoughts are coming in your head, right, don't react to it quickly. Wait for some time, wait for an hour, wait for a day, and then by that time the knee-jerk reaction will be dissipating within you itself. And then probably the pressure on the other side will have also dissipated. So what matters is, you don't react in a knee-jerk fashion, because you can hurt, you can say something really, really, you know, wrong, which you cannot erase once it's said. And again, in these situations, emails are to be handled very delicately. When it comes to a negative situations, you know, open communications with the other side is really important. And always let other person know that, hey, you know, I'm perceiving that this is what is going on. Is this what you really want to do, or am I doing something wrong? What would you like me to do? And sometimes when you ask a question in that fashion, there itself the pressure will be dissipated, and you will have a great time addressing that question.
Madhumita here from Pinmal Engineering College.
Madhumita, is that right?
And one question is. Yeah, Madhumita here, sir.
Uh-huh.
And I need to get some importance regarding the behavior in the workplace, either in case of stress or stress-free. In case of stress, it determines work pressure on team leader. Team leader initiates the employee to, you have to complete with this deadline. Either that employee does not know the concept or skills, how to do that. So he might be asking, as a few said, so I don't have any idea of this. Please just figure out me what I have to implement. So that time, so people, the employees or the team leaders, the colleagues, they may be thinking that these employees insufficient, they are not contributing towards the work they keep on asking. So that word becomes their negative pressure. So how to tackle that in case of stress and stress-free? If we are keeping contact with those colleagues, either in case of sharing the innovations or implementing, these points could be better and efficient. So this takes more importance. So that can be handled. So my question is regarding the stress.
So are you asking me a question, how do you handle stress?
That behavior in the workplace, how to behave in that place.
Okay.
In case of stress.
Okay, got it. Okay, let me reword the question so that if I don't understand the question, you can explain it to me again. So the question is that you have stress in your workplace because certain employees is not behaving correctly, they are not sharing information, and you are asking me how do you deal with it, how do you handle such kind of stress, and how do you do your job?
Asking the questions or some doubts regarding what we have to figure it out. So people, they may be taking that as a negative instead of taking that clarification.
No, so my suggestion to you is in the beginning phase of your career, right, you can ask as many questions as you want, okay? And if people don't like asking questions, then you're in the wrong place, trust me, okay? Because you need to be asking questions, you are in a totally new environment, you need to learn what's going on around you. So you have every right to ask questions. Of course, you cannot ask questions about what you learned in school, right? How do you solve differential equations and things like that, because that's something you've been trained to do. But anything that's relevant to your work, which naturally you're not supposed to know, right, you should ask those questions. And many times what you can do is you can ask them for a reference, you know, maybe you can and the reason people I'll share with you something, right? People who get upset when you ask questions, you know why they get upset?
Because of frustrations.
No, people, they don't know the answers. Most of the time they don't know the answers, and you are asking the questions where they don't know the answers. So when somebody gets upset with you, you have a clue that I've told you that they don't know the answer. Don't ask him the same question again or her same the question. You need to go out and find out another person who will smile at you and let's figure it out together. That kind of approach. So it's trust me, you will be going through a lot of stressful situations in your life. Okay. Now, what you do with that stress is really up to you. Okay. I have gone through this over so many years, right? I've been through so many stressful situations. Some of them are very extreme situations where you can't even sleep at night. You have to learn to deal with stress with certain kind of detachment. You cannot let it, impact you who you are. So the stress will be there. It's part of your job. You have to deal with it with calmness. And objectively try to think about what you really need to do in this situation. Many times the stress will be so unbearable that you feel like you want to react, explode, right? Take a break, leave your place, go for coffee and come back, and the stress will have dissipated. So my advice to you is do not react on any situations where you feel that you are compelled to react, and the stress will be very easy for you to handle. And in terms of dealing with colleagues who are not willing to help you, you have to move on to other people. You have to ask other people. And you have to find the people who are willing to help you. And you will find somebody who is willing to listen to you. And if nobody is willing to listen to you, then it's time to do, what to do.
I can just add to this.
Please.
From my own experience. So I've been holding an administrative position in the last 3 years. So I had to face many of these stressful situations also. And I was also not used to many of these situations in the beginning. So as Professor Zelia said, this is what I did. So sometimes I would just think it over or give it some time so that I don't respond immediately and precipitate the situation, make it worse. Or the best solutions I've got is there are seniors to me who have been through the same experience. I ask them for advice and then I implement that. That has been the easiest thing for me to do. Sometimes if we are not able to solve a problem, we just tell our colleagues, this is a problem. Okay, we can't find a solution immediately, please give us time. Okay, please bear with us. So sometimes it is possible that they will actually listen to you if you are honest about it, saying that you've tried your best, there is a crisis, there is a problem, but we will all together sort it out. We'll call a meeting and sort it out. So you have to find a way in which you address the problem rather than get stressed out and make the situation worse. Okay, so getting into a stressful situation and fretting about it, getting frustrated is not going to lead you anywhere. Okay.
Yeah. One slight point I want to add to, and it's an important important key that I want to give you as students, right? One of the most important thing you can do in a workplace, and especially in a situation where that you describe, right? Let's say Madhumita, right? Madhumita asked this question. Mm-hmm. So Madhumita, you have an issue at work and you came and asked me something and I helped you out, let's say first time, right? Now, next time you talk to somebody else, you mention my name. You know, Rajesh, he really helped me. I'm really thankful to him, right? Mention that in that conversation. Word will get around that you are, you know, you really appreciate this other person's work, and it will work like magic for you. Trust me. You will. Everybody would love to work with you because you are giving other person credit, right? Giving other person credit is the easiest way to get everybody on your side. Okay, people love that. I mean, as human beings, we love that, right? You are at home and you made some really nice dish. Somebody else said something nice about it to other person. You like that, don't you? It's the same way at work. So give other people credit, and if you don't do otherwise, then nobody will want to work with you, right? So give the credit where it is deserved to other person, that so and so person, even a junior person came out and helped you. Once you give them the credit, they will think that, you know, this person is really honest and he really likes to work with other people. He appreciates my help. And he mentions my name in front of other people, which is a great thing for him and great thing for you too. Okay, all right.
Okay, thank you.
Next question.
And how to interact with the higher authority in an organization? If we implement some innovations while we are approaching the authorities, they may be thinking like this is very optimistic. So people, they are expecting for current trends. So if we go for negatives, they are thinking, oh, this is very pessimistic. So how to interact with that higher authorities?
Okay, higher, you interact with all the authorities like a human being, okay? Don't treat them like higher authorities, because if you treat them like higher authorities, right, they will treat you like a lower authority, okay? So you have to treat everybody like a human being, you know, no matter if it's a CEO of a company or whatever CXO of the company, you have to deal with them at a human level. And you have a question, right? You can always pose your questions in such a way that the other person is willing to contribute to the conversation, okay? Let me give you an example. An example would be, this is what you think we should do. Huh? So for example, you think that this in the company needs to change, you guys are not doing it right. What do you think the other person on the will do? They will go on a defensive, because now you are accusing them. Now you are coming out with a suggestion, with a tint of accusation. Whereas you could pose your question in such a way that, hey, you know, I'm observing this, and I think there are some issues with this. You know, maybe we should do that. What do you think? When I ask a question saying, what do you think? Suddenly you are engaging that other person to contribute to this conversation. And that's the trick that you need to use to get, you know, whoever you are interacting with on your side. Okay. Thank you, Madhumita.
Thank you a lot.
Myself, Kajal.
Kajal, okay.
When I apply for an internship, so there are hardly 5 to 6 seats there. So my question is, what are some extra qualities so that I can be a part of that internship? Because there are many people who are fighting for that internship or that campus placement.
Your question is that there are only limited internships available and so many people trying to apply for that internship. And you are asking me, how do you improve your chances? Is that what you're saying? Okay, all
yes,
right.
Sir.
Okay, you asked a very, very interesting question, Kajal, because I'll tell you what I do every day, right? I get emails from students all over India, hundreds of them, okay? And you know what I do? I delete them, okay? So I'll tell you which ones I delete and which ones I read. Okay, I get emails which are like a blank emails, which is they're addressed to all the professors in my department, huh? And or I'm in the BCC, and they don't write my name. I delete them immediately. The second kind of email I delete is where there are spelling mistakes in the content. I delete them immediately. After all these barriers, if the message is not clear, I don't even read those messages. Okay. And then finally, if I find everything appropriate, then I will open up the resume. Again, the same methodology follows. I make sure that the person who is asking me all these things, right, they're genuine and they're not just trying to waste my time. So you can learn from all this and make sure that whatever you write to the other person, you make a personal connection, you write a personal email with address to that person, individual email rather than personal email, and then explain your situation, you will get good results. But if you send out like a blanket email to everyone in the company, you know, most likely nobody will open your email. So the communication should be one-on-one and genuine, and you should explain you know, what you want to do and what skills you have, and you know, maybe then you will have improved chances, at least so that you are in the door for an interview. And at the interview place, you have to follow a lot of other techniques that you have learned through this. They have learned through this course, right? Yeah. So the most important thing, as I said, even in the emails, is making that first impression and making the right first impression. A spelling mistake in an email goes to the delete box. Okay?
Hello.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Deepa Jha, and my question is, so first of all, I want to say that we have learned a lot from this IIT Bombay's website. It has been very interesting for solving all the assignments, and it developed our communication skill as well as how to present ourselves in front of MNCs. And sir, I have one question which I want you to that. Is it necessary to say always yes to all the questions asked by the companies for their benefit?
Really good question. Really good question. If your friend is asking you that question, would you say yes to all those questions?
No, I won't. Actually, sir, I am having an example.
Can you give me an example?
Actually, some college, there are some campus in our college in which the companies ask the question to girls like if they can do night duties or extra work after their working hours. So if they say that they can't do night work or night duties, they directly reject them. So I don't think this is a good thing, because there are many cases we have heard about girls. So that's why my question is it necessary to say yes always for their benefit?
No. I mean, this is Deepa here. This is a really important question that you mentioned. You should not agree to anything that you don't believe in, okay? You have to stick to what you think is right. Just because somebody is putting pressure on you, you don't have to say, or your colleagues are saying yes and you should not have to say yes. You do what you think is right, and you have to stand by that. And in my opinion, you know, what you're seeing right now is not a very fair situation. So I would bring that to attention of your placement office, because I feel it's unfair to ask people to work at nights. Having said that, there will be times when you're working, right? You will be under a lot of time pressure to finish something, and occasionally there is always you have to work extra hours, long hours, and sometimes even at night. I don't think you should be against that, because as long as it happens rarely, because at that time everyone's future is tied to something getting on time, right? So then people do this extra, beyond what is expected, they do these things, and you should be okay with that, in my opinion, as long as it's occasional and necessary. Okay.
I can give you a suggestion. So in IIT Bombay, recently we had people from the Deutsche Bank coming and addressing women students here, because women students sometimes get asked very awkward questions which should not be asked by companies, and they don't ask the same questions to men. So the Deutsche Bank actually trained these women who are going to sit for placement on how to respond to this. So they are doing this as part of their CSR activities. So I suggest you also get in touch with Deutsche Bank, and maybe we can give you those contacts later if you can contact us offline. And there are many other women's organizations, NGOs, who will help you in this. Your placement officer, you should talk to about this, so they can help you out on these kinds of issues. Okay? Yeah.
Okay, sir.
One thing that's really important is, you know, different genders, right? You are on equal footing. You know, you should not take a back seat. It's, you have equal right to the same job. You have to believe in that first yourself, and then you will get what you want. So believing in that is important, because if you don't believe in that and if you cave in, then that means the other side will take advantage of you. IERCEM. Yes. Okay. Oh, this is from West Bengal. Okay. Hello. What is your name?
Sir, my question is, what are the qualities of a good professional?
That was the lecture that we talked about, right? I hope you went through the lecture. I hope you learn from that. So,
hello, sir.
Yes. What is your name?
I am Surya Bhargav, sir. Thank you for having us, sir. I have some questions about workplace communication as well as soft skills. Can I ask them now?
Of course. Shoot.
If we got a situation like we are heading a team, that is, we are leading a team in a project. Some of the team members are not supporting us. That means they are not doing their work which we are given to them, and they are making us to feel important. How can we handle the situation so that we can make that situation favor to us, sir?
Okay, if I understand your question, you are a team leader. You are working in a company, and some of the people in your team, they are not doing any work. And then how do you deal with them, is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, dealing with people who don't work, right, is very common. A good way to handle such situation is track. The key word is tracking. Okay. So, as a leader, you need to track who is doing what. So, as a leader, you need to identify who is going to do what first. Okay, always. So, let's say you have a team of 5 people, then you need to identify, you need to have a good communication with your team. Granted that 2 or 3 people are not listening to you, it's perfectly fine. But you need to let them know that this is what you expect them to do and in this much amount of time. And after that, you need to let go of them. Okay, you cannot go after them every 1 hour, have you done this, have you done that, right? Then they will be turned off. If there is already an animosity or unpleasant behavior, it will exaggerate a little further. So, but as a leader, your responsibility is to get things done without any pain, as little friction and as little pain in the team, right? And rest of the team will realize that what you are trying to do. You have to be factual. You have to communicate with everyone the same way, and you have to let them know what your expectations are. And if somebody doesn't fulfill your expectations, you need to let them know too. You just have to be calm and composed about it. You don't have to scream. You just have to let them that this is what you expected and it's not getting done on time and you don't appreciate that. And I think rather than having a shouting match, just letting other person know that you're not happy about something works wonders. Because I think when you say something negative without being emotional, it does about 10x impact on the other side. I'm telling you from my personal experience. So do that and you will see the magic happen. People will fall in line. And what you also, as I said earlier, if you get my thread, whoever is doing the right work, you need to really appreciate what they're doing. And you need to reward them, not monetarily or any other things. But you can always sing their praise, right? I really appreciate you did this on time and thank you. When you say something like that, it makes an impact on other people who are not getting that warm feeling, right? So, as humans, we always want positive reinforcement. And you give the positive reinforcement to people who are doing the work for you. And you always talk about those people with your superiors or whoever in the organization with high respect. And rest of the people will figure it out. right? So so then they will also want to do work with you, and they know that if they do good work, they'll get appreciated. So that's a good way to get things done with a positive reinforcement. You have any?
Sir, I had another question. In workplace, being a professional, we need to avoid the personal discussions between our colleagues, isn't it, sir?
Absolutely.
If any person is going into personals like that we are not want to discuss, and he is going into personals even he feels we are uncomfortable, how can we tell them and without hurting them, so that we can get rid of that situation, sir?
You just said the answer right now. That's exactly what you need to tell the other person. You just tell them that you are uncomfortable talking about this. Very simple. Move away.
That means if we tell directly, it makes them hurt. How can
Why should the other side be hurt? You're just not comfortable. Very simple. And people will ask you a question once and twice, and then after that they will not do that. If there is something private in your private life you don't want to share with that person, you have 100% right to protect yourself. Okay? So do not talk about stuff you're not comfortable. So you, Surya, you brought this thought in my mind. Thank you for this. You can sit down if you want to, because I want to. There is something. Me and my wife, we discussed this many times, right? And we are both professionals. So she looked at the presentation I did, and she said, "You forgot this." And so whatever I forgot is what I'm going to tell you now. So here is, and Surya, you kind of gave me a great segue to explain what she said to me. So one of the things, my personal experience has been in Indian workplace, or not so much in US, but in India itself, is people talk to each other about their salaries openly, okay? And my opinion is that your salary is your private data. You don't have to share it with other person. There will be situation when you are happy with whatever you are getting, but you are unhappy suddenly because somebody is getting 10 rupees more than you. Okay, because humans are very relative. You are always relative, thinking relatively. You judge other person in your mind, and you put a number on them, and you always put a lower number on the other person. And if that person is getting more money than you, for whatever reason, you feel unhappy. So that's one reason. And other reason is it will affect your work, whatever you are doing, because this thought of salary will be always in the back of your mind. So salary is a private information. Don't try to find somebody else's salary, okay? Imagine that your workplace is a fair place. You are getting what you deserve. The other person is getting what he deserves or she deserves. So don't get into other person's salary. And the second thing you brought out is, I also see somebody asking me what caste I am from. And I was like, this is the first time ever in my life somebody asked me what caste I am from. Because I never thought about caste as a question, right? And this happened to me very recently, about 2 years ago, when I was giving a talk at some place. And I was so shocked that it took me a while to react to that question. But I had to wait, pause, and, you know, do all those techniques and, you know, not react to that situation. And I just ignored that question. That's the way I dealt with it. I didn't want to react to it. So the point I'm trying to make is, you know, do not ask other person all these private questions, which caste, whatever religion, whatever they are from, you know, because at workplace you are all equal, you are there to do your job, and you are there to help each other. And don't let any of these biases come into your workplace, because once they enter the bias, it's a devil that's in your mind, and that devil will kill you. And it will kill your work, and then it will be, you know, your own destruction. So don't let all these things affect you. Don't ask all these uncomfortable questions to others. And if somebody asks you uncomfortable questions, shy away from them, saying that I really don't want to talk about it. I'm not comfortable. Okay? And that goes about your personal situations. Are you married? Are you going to get married? How many kids you have? Once you have an established relationship with a person, right? And if he becomes truly your friend outside the work, by all means you can share whatever you feel like. And at that point, it's your call what to share, okay? Because humans, by definition, are always judging other people, okay? So once you share the information in the private syntax, they will be judging you. Okay, so be prepared for that. And one example would be, I'll give you an example, right? As a don't take it the wrong way, but let's say that you are you're a single person, okay? And if you're a single person, then the judgment on the other side is going to be, oh, he can work hard and he can come in at nights, he can work through the weekends. But if the person is married, then maybe no, you know, he won't be able to put in as much time. So these kind of judgments happen all the time, subconsciously many times. Many times people are not thinking about these things. So I'm not saying that you should become an ultra private person with no information, but you have to take that call, what information you release, okay? Thank you. So the question is, if the supervisor is partial to one of his subordinates, how does other subordinate handle the situation? It will happen to you. Trust me, it will happen to you, and it will feel good if you are the partial candidate, whatever that is, but it will not feel good at all when you are on the other side. And you know, you can complain about it or you can handle it gracefully. And I approach it with how do you deal with this situation gracefully. First of all, you can there is not much you can do unless that person is doing something writing or via you know, expressing it where other people are present, right? And where they notice that this partial behavior is uncalled for, right? For example, if somebody is passed up for promotion and other one is not given a promotion, you can always question, you can always talk to the supervisors, you can have a fair discussion with your supervisor. You should have complete access to people in the hierarchy. And always go with, you know, don't go with attack mode, you know, in these situations. Always ask questions, you know, hey, can you explain why this happened? What am I doing wrong? Because when you ask questions like this, then the other person will be on your side. They will not go in the defensive, they will give you advice, and you will also bring it to other person's notice that, hey, this is what is happening and it's really not right. And if the supervisor or the person in the higher authority is really a fair person, then he will make sure that things are right, corrected. So again, you know, you can't really confront people in a negative manner, but you can always bring it out in a one-on-one discussion in a delicate manner. As I said, you know, hey, maybe I'm doing something wrong. Can you explain what I need to do to do as well as this other person? You know, this other person deserved, I'm sure he deserved or she deserved whatever she got, but then what do I need to do? And when you ask questions like this, it will become very clear that the decision making wasn't exactly fair. And human beings are such that, you know, once you make them aware, and once they know that everyone else is around them is aware, then they try to avoid those situations and things will stop. So you have to handle this gracefully. If you go storm into the supervisor's office and, hey, you know, attack that person or whatever that is, then the things may not be the way you want them to be, okay? Yeah, do you guys have any questions?
So my question is about the professional conduct which we need to decide in institutions or in organizations. So how do we interact with them in the campus or outside the campus? It should be same or we need to perform it differently?
Yeah, what is your name?
So my name is Akash.
Akash, okay, Akash. So your question is that how should you interact with people as a professional in campus versus outside campus? Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't see why the campus should make a difference in your behavior. You can be in campus or outside the campus. You should extend the same professional courtesy to other people. You were asking.
We can't make uncomfortable when we meet them outside the campus. So we do not make eye contact, and there is a feeling of what we say. Yeah.
No, please do say that, because articulate what your question is, because I'm sure many of the other people have the same question. So feel free to please say that again, so I understand your question.
Whenever we meet our superiors outside our campus or outside the organization, we tend to feel a little nervous. Okay, yes. So we just don't make eye contact, or we just slip out of it. So that is the kind of nervousness we feel. So how should we overcome it?
So the eye contact is matter of confidence. What kind of confidence you have about yourself, how much you believe in yourself. I think once you start believing in yourself, you will make the eye contact. So, you know, don't worry about that. Again, you know, when you are interacting with your supervisor or anyone else in the organization, right, you just have to be, you know, you just have to be nice to them, and you have to extend the same courtesy that you would extend with respect. And if you give other person respect, they will give you the same respect. You know, that's the way the respect works. It doesn't have to be with superior and inferior persons, right? We are all equal. It just happens that that person was born before you or has had experience before you, and he just happens to be a little bit higher in the chain than you are. Doesn't matter, doesn't mean that you are not going to get there, doesn't mean that you are not going to go beyond that person. So you should have that confidence in you and your abilities, but you just give them the same respect that you give other person, right? You, if you treat people with respect, it will be obvious. However, if you ignore them and if you try to shy away from them, then there is not much that other person can do also, right? So you treat the other side with respect, not respect to the extent of subservientness that you will do anything that they want you to do. The respect has to be mutual. The other person has to treat you with the same respect, and it has to be a professional interaction. So, you know, the respect should not be that they ask you, hey, go get some coffee for me, right? That will be totally not right. And at that time, I would react that, why don't you get it yourself, right? And can you get some for me also? No, I'm kidding here, you know. Don't do that, you know. The point I'm trying to make is that the respect has to be mutual. It has to be professional. And then there will be times when you help the other person beyond what's expected, but there'll be times when they will do the same for you. Okay, so it's a mutual interaction. That's that you have to take it as it comes.
Sir, I am Ashwini.
Hello, Ashwini.
My question is that, see, in a workplace, we are under stress, and we are given overload work, but we couldn't manage it. But it must that we should do that situation. And in that case, how could we manage our stress or overload work, and how could we tackle the situation?
Yeah, you will be, there'll be times when there'll be too much work to do, right? And you can be under stress. But I think the best you can do is you're working for a certain amount of time, and in that time efficiently, how much can you finish, right? Get those things out of the way. You have to manage your time very well. If you efficiently manage your time, maybe then the amount of workload coming to you, maybe you can sort it out a lot faster than you think. And get help from people. It's okay to ask for help, and it's always okay to say, I don't think I can complete this in time. Maybe I can complete these things in time. You know, just outline your, one of the most important things I need to tell you, I hope you learned from my presentation, that you need to set expectations. If you set expectations, let's say somebody gives you a pile of work, right, and you said okay, that means you have set an expectation that that work will be done in that amount of time. So you need to say that, you can leave it there, or I can take it, but I don't think I can finish so many things. But here is what I think I can finish in this time. Or you can always give a timeline saying that I can finish so many things at this time, so many things after this time, things like that. So that way you have set an expectation on the other side, saying that with reasonable amount of work, you can finish so many things at so and so time. And nobody will punish you for work that is not completed, right? Because they just gave you too much, right? So, and they will also remember that, you know, you actually set expectations and you met the expectations. If you accept something and if you don't deliver in a given time, then that's not good. I mean, people can come back at you with negative feelings. But if you Even if you got more, you upfront said that, you know, I would love to do all this work, but then I only have so much time and I have to finish so many things. And I think I can, so many things out of this I can finish in this amount of time. You have set expectations about what you can do at that point. And it's okay. It's okay that you don't have to stay there overnight doing all these things, right? Because many times people on the other side will push you to do that. And you have to make sure you stand where you want to stand at that point. Okay? Thank you.
If I can just add to this, you just need to be explicit about your own abilities, the time available to you, and whether you can fulfill the expectations. So, you know, as a faculty here, I also tend to depend on students for various kinds of work, either in research or organizing conferences, events, projects, and so on. So usually what happens is I tend to depend on students who I know will handle the job well, will perform the tasks. I know some people cannot. So sometimes what happens is, without realizing it, I tend to overburden some students because I know they can do the job. And they come and tell me sometimes. So I sometimes realize that they cannot do it themselves, so I assign somebody else. They will come and tell me, sir, I know this person will not work with me. This person will not do the work. So please don't assign him. Please, I will select somebody who will do the work for me. Okay, so that's what you should be doing also. Okay, you choose a partner who you think can help you in the work and go to your supervisor and tell them we both will do it together. That's absolutely fine. Okay, so you don't necessarily have to accept somebody else who has been assigned to you if you're not comfortable. Yeah.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. So my name is Anish Jain.
Anish.
What if boss asks me a question instead of immediately rejecting my idea? What should I do at that situation?
The question is, what should I do when my boss asks me a question instead of rejecting my idea? Is that the question?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
I mean, that's the kind of boss you need to have, right? You want to have somebody who will not reject your ideas outright, but pose questions. Because questions are posed in such a way that they make you think. They make you think about, maybe you have not thought about these situations. Maybe you have not thought about this application. And the question should be always welcome, because if you become defensive for those questions, then it will be very uncomfortable for you and for the other side also. So it's really important to listen. You know, most important thing you need to do at workplace is listen. You have to listen to other people, and you have to kind of internalize what the feedback they are giving you, and then you have to react. So if somebody asks you a question, that means they are interested in what you are doing. If they just say yes, 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 and they move on to something else, that means they don't care, right? But if they ask you a question, that means they really thought about what you're saying, and they have asked you a question which is relevant to what you're saying. So you should welcome the question and try to find an answer to that question.
Okay. So, but at last I found that my boss liked my idea. And so what should I do at that situation? I have to go with my boss cabin and ask that why you reject my idea, or I have to say that you like my idea, so can you please give me some opinions on that? What should I do?
I am a little bit confused. Your boss is liking your idea, right? So then there is nothing better than
sir. But sir, at last I found out that my boss like my idea, but at that time, at that situation, he was just asking me questions about that, but not related to my idea. So I felt that the boss reject my idea, but at last I found that boss like my idea. So in that situation, what should I do?
Yeah. I mean, the Indian way of doing things is, we don't like to tell other person that you like them, right? Do your parents tell you every night that they love you? Do they?
Okay.
They do?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Every night your parents tell you that they love you?
Yes, sir, and they tell me good night, and yeah, they okay. Not but not
you
an
got a great
night,
parents
like in a week.
Yeah,
thank you, sir.
Oh, that's good. No, I'm trying to illustrate a point that people are different and they have different ways to express themselves. So generally in what I have found is, in India, people are not very open about they will not tell you openly on your face something that's great and good, but when they are in a conversation with someone else, they will tell them that, hey, you know, this kid is really sharp, I really like his idea, and that happens all the time. So don't be discouraged, that's all I'm trying to tell you, because like many times I don't tell that to my students either, even though I know that they're doing good, because I want them to do even better, right? So I raise the bar higher up so that they can do even better. And so it's in your good that he's not pampering you, but you know, you got to follow your instinct. You got to pursue your ideas. If you believe they're good and looks like you have a healthy relationship with your boss, then you got to pursue that idea further. And I'm sure you will make inroads and take your idea further.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. All right. First, I would like to thank all of you come here on Saturday afternoon and listen to this discussion. I'm really happy that you're asking all these really important questions, because it gets me in your head about what you're thinking, and then I will use that information in my my next presentation whenever I get an opportunity with students. Right. So it does help me. What the key thing I would like to tell you is, it's really important. It's really important in workplace to communicate with whoever you are around, okay, and communicate with your heart open, and you know, there will be no, you know, you can't go wrong. If you believe in yourself, if you follow your instincts, then you will be successful. So on the other side, right, your boss is always looking for people who is doing that, and they can trust people who are communicating, who are very honest, and you know, who are willing to make an effort. So if you do that, you will definitely succeed. Please follow the points I gave you, think about them, and you know, internalize them, and then utilize them when you are in your professional environment. Thank you again.
So I would like to thank Professor Zelia on behalf of all of you and the team here.